Hi, Mitch Wenger back with another video on data analytics and machine learning. In this video, we'll talk about the expected value framework. Hope you enjoy. All right, let's get started. We've been building up to this with the last few videos, and now we're ready to discuss a useful conceptual tool to aid in our data analytic thinking, expected value. Many of you are already familiar with the concept of expected value, which is great. This gives you a solid foundation to follow along with as we discuss how to build expected values in the data mining world. Now, the expected value computation decomposes our data analytic problem into three important facets. First, the structure of the problem. Next, the elements of the analysis that we can extract from the data. And then finally, the elements of the analysis that we need to acquire from other sources. In general, we'll be relying on business knowledge or subject matter experts. For our expected value calculation, we need to enumerate all possible outcomes of the situation we're investigating. What is the expected value? Well, in general, expected value is simply the weighted average of the values of different possible outcomes, where the weight given to each value is the probability of it occurring. A typical example would be the different levels of profit we might achieve for various outcomes. As we work our way through our models, our goal usually is to focus on maximizing our expected profit or, conversely, minimizing our expected cost. And you can see the general form of the expected value computation here. We've got the probability for each O, each possible outcome, outcome one, outcome two, outcome three, etc., times the value of that outcome. So we can estimate the probabilities with the data we have available. And that's that second consideration we just talked about. But in order to determine what the value of that outcome is, we'll likely need to acquire the values for each potential outcome, the costs and the benefits, from other sources. So that's our third consideration we just talked about. Let's walk through an example where we want to use a classifier to predict a class and take some action based on our classification results. Target marketing is a good example. We'll assign each consumer to either a class likely responder or not likely to respond. And you can also use this approach for determining the likelihood that a transaction is fraudulent, for example. Now, responses are usually relatively low in a lot of scenarios, so as a default, we might predict that nobody is likely to respond. Breaking it down from that initial assumption, we can compute the expected value by estimating the probability of response, probability of R, for any consumer with a feature vector X. Now we'll have to calculate the expected benefit or costs of targeting this consumer X, like so. The probability of a response by X times the value of that response plus 1 minus the probability of a response by X. So this is their probability of a non-response times the value of that non-response. That's the equation you see right there. Now, if we start filling in the values, we could say the price of the product is $200. The cost to create that product is $100. So we have a margin of $100 on the product itself. Next, we need to figure out how much it costs to target the consumer. If it costs us a dollar to send them an offer, we can now determine the value of a response, $99, and the value of a non-response, -$1, the $1 we spent to send them the offer. So how do we know whether we make a profit? In other words, is our expected value of targeting these consumers greater than zero? Well, if we plug our numeric values into the equation and remove all the elements that include the estimated probability of a response over to the left side of the equation, we can see that we have a positive value, i.e. a profit, as long as our estimated probability of response exceeds 1%. So we should target the consumer as long as we estimate that the probability of response for that particular consumer is greater than 1%. Now we have the ability to compare the quality of different models and even modeling techniques against each other. Will our data-driven model outperform one that we create by hand simply using our domain knowledge? Does a tree outperform a linear discriminant? Do any of them outperform our baseline model? With the expected value framework, we now have a useful, practical approach to make these determinations. For each data-driven model, we can mine the data to develop our model using the training data that we have available to us. Then we can test it against holdout data to develop a confusion matrix. From that confusion matrix, we can estimate accuracy rates for each class, isolating our test data's class distribution from our expected class distribution. This is an important thing to remember, as we'll see how we can take advantage of that isolation to build better models in just a few minutes and also in upcoming videos. Next, we can apply our class accuracy rates against our expected class distribution to the full population, creating a probability matrix for the various types of outcomes. Meanwhile, probably in the business understanding phase of the project, we have determined the costs and the benefits for our potential outcomes. By multiplying that probability matrix by the cost-benefit matrix and summing the totals, we can derive our estimated value for each model. Now let's step back and walk through this with our example. Okay, so we've mined our data with 61 positive cases and 39 negative cases. From the confusion matrix, we can calculate the probabilities for each of our potential outcomes. If we target, what is the probability of non-response? If we don't, what is the probability that they would have responded? And so on with the other possibilities. Because we had 100 examples, this is pretty easy. But you won't always have nice, neat quantities like this, so make sure you check your probability calculations. We end up with the probability matrix you see on the right. We can develop a cost-benefit matrix by entering the cost-benefit values for each cell we have in our confusion matrix. Correct classifications, true positives and negatives, are on the main diagonal. Incorrect classifications, false positives and negatives in this case, are any cell that's not on that main diagonal. Each cell now contains the net benefit, or a negative number for a net cost, for each potential outcome. It's important to note that our training data and data mining model do not estimate the costs and benefits. Organizations, at least for now, still have to estimate and calculate them the old-fashioned way. For the most part, you need to answer questions like, how much is it worth to retain a customer? How much will we recover, or how much loss will we prevent if we detect a fraud? In general, we typically begin by using average costs and benefits to evaluate our models. We'll talk about ways to get more specific in upcoming videos. Now we can take our probability matrix, our benefit matrix, apply a little matrix algebra, and we are able to calculate our expected value for this model. This expected value means that if we apply this model to a population of prospective customers and mail offers to those it classifies as positive, we can expect to make an average of about $56.07 profit per consumer. With 100 customers in my data set, I would anticipate a net benefit of $5,607. Now, this example presents a pretty good scenario. Many scenarios will have a much smaller proportion of the positive class. As we'll see, we can still use what we have here and adjust our expected value based on our expected class distribution. Note that we can also calculate a number of important ratios. For the positive class, what is our rate of true positives versus false negatives? For our negative class, what is the true negative rate? What is the false positive rate? We can use these rates as we test different estimated class distributions. Now, let's say that we expect the actual population to have a different class distribution than the distribution we had in the training data set. Here's our original data set. You can see we have our 61% positives and 39% negatives. Perhaps we got this data from a repository of cases that someone had put together, you know, based on human intuition, and it ended up being pretty good. And then they later on added the final disposition of the case to the data. So initial intuition led to a higher representation of positive cases than we would expect for the entire population. Now, what if we actually expect the distribution of the full population to be 75% negative and only 25% positive? This is where a concept called priors comes in. From our confusion matrix, we can calculate the accuracy of each class separately. We saw those just a minute ago as true positives, false negatives, true negatives, and false positives. In our model, the positive class was predicted correctly 91.8% of the time by our data mining model, leaving 8.2% that were false negatives. Similarly, negatives were predicted correctly 82.1% of the time by our new model, leaving 17.9% false positives. Now we can apply those accuracy percentages to our expected population distribution and come up with a new probability matrix. We then substitute our new probability matrix into the expected value framework, and we're able to calculate a whole new expected value for our model. In fact, we can test the robustness of our model by seeing how it performs with different priors. Mathematically, we can factor out the probabilities for each class, the class priors, and we can now calculate expected value as a function that adds the expected value of positive examples to the expected value of negative examples, like you see here. Keep in mind that we can extend this concept, and therefore this equation, to include however many classes our target attribute contains. So our class priors, in this case represented by probability of positive, PP, and probability of negative, PN, specify the likelihood of each type of instance. By factoring, we have now separated our priors regarding class imbalances from the predictive power of the model. Now we can not only compare different models, we can also compare how the models perform given different potential distributions of our classes. If we go back to our visual model of the expected value framework, we can apply our accuracy rates for each class to our expected population distribution and come up with a new probability matrix. We can now drop our new probability matrix into the expected value framework, and we're able to calculate that new EV for our model. In fact, we can test the robustness of our model by seeing how well it performs with several different priors. This makes the expected value framework extremely powerful for building business cases for data mining efforts. We'll discuss robustness in more detail in upcoming videos. So, instead of computing accuracy rates for our various models, we can compute expected values. Even if one model is based on a representative distribution, say the 90-10 distribution we expect, and another model has been based and trained on a balanced training set, a 50-50 split, all we have to do is change the priors and recalculate. Now, there are a couple things to watch out for. You need to make sure that the signs in the cost-benefit matrix are consistent. You also want to resist the urge to double count by placing a benefit in one cell and a negative cost for the same thing in another cell. So you just need to make sure you understand exactly how you're setting up that cost-benefit matrix. As a final note, we did mention a few different measures and ratios you might encounter in the data mining world. As a reference, here are a number of the more commonly used measures. Precision, which is the accuracy of all positive predictions, and recall, or sensitivity, which is the accuracy across all positive cases, are two of the most important measures to understand. That's it for this discussion of the expected value framework. I hope you found it useful. As always, be sure to check out the other videos in this series.